Hello, this is Franklin Wepner, making another video here about this process that I'm doing with my sidekick here. His name is Aharon, Chaim, and is another name, but that's supposed to be a secret, okay? So we're going to call him Mr. Blank. And we're doing a very important process now. What we're doing is summarizing everything he's done up till now in the previous three videos, and then making the next step, which is to go for this transition from being a, you might say, a sort of a patient, though really I don't think of this as therapy, it's more just a growth process, to being a performer and using the same material, they call it using your discards, using this material, these layers of the onion that you peeled away, this ego crud that you peeled away from yourself, using it as creative material. And that takes a little bit of doing. It's not the most obvious thing in the world. For example, you know, we usually feel very, very special about this sort of thing. Subjectively, we're very embarrassed and ashamed, and you know, so we need a little exercise. We're going to show you later on, called mocking your forms, which is a way of alienating yourself, moving away from that stuff and getting some distance from it, so that you can feel free to play with it. Okay, that's a little further down the road. What I'm going to do at the beginning here is a little bit of theory. I hope you're going to look at the other, at least the last two of the videos that he did. There are three of them. And to see where it's coming from. But assuming, let's assume you did that. I can't go repeat everything every single time. We never get ahead. So I'm going to assume you looked at that. I got some notes here. I'm going to follow my notes. Okay. So the general topic of this video, Chaim, do me a favor, don't bob up and down like that.
Okay, sorry.
All right? It distracts me. Just be a statue, all right? Either up or down, but you don't have to do anything. Just if it's okay, if it's okay, all right? Don't worry about it. All right, let me just do it, okay? All right. Pause. I'll edit it out, okay? All right. So now, in general, we're going to call this video the Gestalt Theater Model. I'm illustrating a certain model, a certain way of working called Gestalt Theater. Even though in the process of this, I'm going to be using all kinds of techniques from Michael Chekhov, some stuff from Stanislavski, and Mabu Minds, and whatever else I throw in here. Why I'm calling it Gestalt Theater Model, because what's unique about it is that these other guys don't do, is to make a lot of use of the Gestalt work that somebody does as active preparation. I'm not calling it therapy, we're calling it active preparation. Okay. Now I'm going to assume also that you know something about what Gestalt therapy is, but just briefly, working with awareness and dreams and personal relationships and setting up oppositions where you taught yourself talking to different sides of yourself in the empty chair, and then what they call the rhythm of contact and withdrawal. Once you've done the dialogue, then you close your eyes, go inside and get an image, get a new idea, and it takes you to another level of the cycle. And the context here is the dialectical thinking, where it's thesis, antithesis, synthesis. You're starting off with yourself, and then you split yourself into two opposites, the antitheses, and then you get the synthesis of the new idea that integrates the two sides of yourself. That's the basic background theory here. Okay. Now, let's focus on specifically on Michael Chekhov technique and what he calls the psychological gesture. Psychological gesture. And what he also labels this process psychophysical theater. And I want to first of all point out that when he talks about psychophysical theater, he's referring to the psyche and not so much what we call psychology these days. So it's in a sense soul-body theater, psychophysical soul-body. And as a matter of fact, if we think about the Kabbalah, those happen to be the third and fourth layers down from the four worlds. You know, there's emanation, first world, Bria, creation, second world. Those two are the uncreated level. Then the third level is the Yetzirah, the opposites, the soul. That's the soul part. And then physical, the lowest level, Asiya, the world of doing. That's the one of the body, in a sense, in a broader sense. So psychophysical is referring to this, the soul and the body and the relationship between them. And Chekhov talks about the energetic body, and that's what he's talking about. He's talking about those connections. Okay, again, I'm not going to get spend a lot of time in the theory. So let's talk about these PGs, so psychological gestures. The way he usually does it in his classes is he has people do some physical work to get to some what he calls psychological gestures. At least this is what his students do anyway. I haven't seen him do these exercises. So for example, the typical thing is to tell the students, okay, everybody open up as much as you can, and now be aware of what you're doing very much, and now close up as much as you can, and be aware of what you're doing very much, and now you know what it's like to open and to close. And that's going to call, we're going to call that a psychological gesture. And now imagine that you're doing that in your mind. You're closing and closing and closing and closing. And now I want you to say hello as you're closing. And so you're going to say hello, hello. And you're thinking, I'm closing, I'm closing, I'm closing. And I say hello, 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 hello. And now I want you to say hello, hello, hello as you're opening. And I'm going to think, I'm thinking I'm opening. And hello, hello, hello. Hello, 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 and somehow I got bigger, I don't know. And maybe it affected my speech a little bit. That's the basic mechanism of psychological gestures, starting with something physical, going to something inside in the soul, and as a matter of fact, it's an opposition between open and closed, so it fits into the category of oppositions right there also. And the relationship of this this inner light coming from further up, you know, illuminating the saying hello gives us what we call live form versus dead form. If I just say hello, hello, that's my primitive, everyday, naturalistic self. Whereas if I use the PG, supposedly I have illuminated that hello, hello. And we saw that it has a little bit of effect, but frankly not much effect. And how is it possible, the next question is, if we did the process right, how come we don't get results? Or we get anemic results? Well, and my answer is that we didn't do the process quite right. Actually, we didn't get the PGs from a deep enough source. Just to simply tell somebody, open, close like an accordion, ain't gonna work. I mean, it works if, you know, if you're 20 people in an acting class paying $500 an hour for the class, and you think you're gonna get some, the more you pay, the more you're gonna get, something like that. Then you go home and try it. Then you go to the studio and try to make it work. And how come I didn't get the gig? You know, you can't figure it out. Okay. There's a better way to do it, folks, and that's what we're going to demonstrate today. And the way we're making a distinction here between what I'm calling essential PGs and what we'll call actor PGs. The actor PGs are the kind we just talked about. And the essential ones are the ones that come out of doing gestalt work or something like that, where you're dealing with essences, essential essences. Get it? Connection, essence, essential. What are these essences? The same idea, like open and close. They're opposites, and they come out of, the difference is that they come out of a stream of concentration. In my case, I work 3 hours usually with a person. So there's a lot of concentration, a lot of focus, concenter, a lot of focusing, centering, and leading to, usually, to discovering different sides of yourself and then setting them up as a conversation between the two sides. And I hope you'll look at Mr. Blank's work here on the other videos and see how he does it. He does it very well and he gets results. We have from him we get very clear, I think we found 4 major points where he had very clear oppositions, where there's physical and vocal oppositions and very clear psychological oppositions, polarities. And usually we go inside and find a new idea, and each time the process worked very well. So what we're going to see from him is, first, the first thing you'll see from him is a demonstration of exactly what I just said. He's going to string these four major moments together and make it into a kind of a physical theater piece. He's just going to show it to you raw, the basic underlying physical, psychological, or now we're calling it psychic soul body relationship here, the psychophysical relationship. Usually, you know, going back to what we did at the beginning, remember, the PG was internalized and the vocal track was saying hello. So we have a mask. We have a relationship between a mask or a filter or an overlay, whatever you want to call it, versus the underlying, the inner source. And the same thing here. But what you're going to see so far is just the underlying material without the overlay. And a little later in the video, we're going to show you how it's exactly how we overlay different things on this basic skeleton of the skeleton has a very technical name, which I got from reading a little bit of Hegel's philosophy. He calls it the objective history, in the sense that these essences are something objective that come out of awareness work, whereas the opposite of that would be what your subjective opinion of yourself, that you usually, the habits you have, that you're comfortable with, and your subjective life, your everyday, what CHEKHOV calls your primitive, everyday, natural self. So this objective history is what you're going to see. And of course, in a sense, even the objective history is already a mask, because what he's masking, he's, look at it this way, doing the total of, by the way, he did not do dream work. We didn't get to the dream work yet. He only did one simple session, 2 hours on awareness. So what he's got is still pretty anemic stuff. It's still just very weak gestalts, as we say, weak patterns. But still, even given that, it's still very impressive how much he got out of that. So if you look at the guy that you'll see doing the exercise, he's the guy, the guy that is finished with the process, and he can look back at it and talk about how he learned this, and then I learned this, and then I discovered this, with hindsight, the wisdom of hindsight. And so that wisdom, the position of the wisdom of hindsight, is the position of the superobjective. The superobjective. And he's looking back at the different beats, the different major objective obstacle relationships that he went through to get to that superobjective. So he's doing, in a sense, he's doing what actors usually do backwards. Usually actors start off with a little objective this scene, and then gradually, if they're lucky, they'll discover some kind of a superobjective. In this case, he knows a superobjective because he's finished with the process and he's looking back at it. And so we're going to do a little exercise where he's going to, from the point of view of his present day self, he's going to look back and tell you what it's like, what it was like in each of those, when he worked through each of those slices of the salami, or each of those beats of the, by the way, if you're into theory, we could say that the thing that pulls the whole thing forward, Aristotle would call the unmoved mover, and the idea that traditionally they talk about a kind of a magnet pulling the process forward. The opposite of that would be Plato, which talks about working backward towards origin, and anesis, remembering things. Well, here in Aristotle, it's moving forward towards some kind of an ideal state of integration. So from the point of view of this ideal state of integration, he's going to be looking back at the stages he went through to get to that. Okay, let's see what I got in my list here. I covered that. Okay, now Stanislavski. If you read Creating a Role, which was Stanislavski's first book, it was the last one published, but it was the first one he wrote for some reason or other, and you read the first two-thirds of the book, it's describing three stages of the process, which is exactly parallel to Gestalt therapy. And it's exactly the opposite of what CHEKHOV these days is doing. So putting the two together, CHEKHOV and Aristotle, instead of having to choose between one and the other, CHEKHOV and Stanislavski, instead of having to choose between one of them and the other one, is what we're trying to do here and what I recommend. That way, when you talk about an actor preparation, you're giving the actor two sets of tools. You're giving him the Chekhov tools and you're giving him the Stanislavski tools together. Why am I saying that? Because if you read carefully what Stanislavski says in that book, he breaks the preparation process down to working on a preparation of a role. He breaks it down into three stages. The period of study, period of emotional experience, and the period of physical embodiment. Now, the physical period of study is, in a sense, does, as a matter of fact, risk getting the criticism that Chekhov actors like to say, oh, he's too, Stanislavski was too mental, you know, and we're being spiritual, and we're being much on a higher level. But as a matter of fact, if you keep reading in that first section of the period of study, the last part of it is called appraising the facts. Now, what does it mean by appraising the facts? Well, later on he uses the same, in the same context, he talks about testing the facts or experimenting with the facts. All three things refer to, and then he illustrates the process. And what does he do? He simply has an imaginary dialogue with a scene partner, whether I think it's Sophie or Sonia, whatever it is. He plays both sides, and he does, in other words, exactly what you do when you do Gestalt therapy with the two chairs, same thing. Except he didn't call it therapy, he called it theater. So everybody else calls it theater. In the second part, where he calls it a period of emotional experience, emotional experience, your period of emotional experience. And he says in the beginning of that section, he says that this is the most important part of the process. And what is it? Exactly what we do in Gestalt therapy. In other words, you set up these the imaginary dialogues, identifications, you talk to something, whatever it is, and then you identify and play that side. You go back and forth a couple of times to set up the relationships, and then you've internalized that, the opposites, and you have an overall view of what's going on there. And then you keep going with that, you're going to get to the superobjective, what he calls the superconsciousness. And he says, oh, but it's so mysterious, you know. But it's not mysterious. We just did it. You're going to see it. If you look at Mr. Blank's work, you're going to see exactly he did it. It's not mysterious, you know. It's obvious. Okay, so what I'm saying then, and then the period of embodiment, the third part of the process, is exactly what we're going to show you later. We're going to show you how you put an overlay on that basic objective history there. Okay, so now I want to illustrate using these Russian dolls here a little bit of you might say this is I guess it refers to the theosophy that the Russians were into, but it also is a beautiful example of the way of talking about the Kabbalah. You have a outer layer and a medium layer and an inner layer.
Hello.
Okay. Now, if you think of this as concentric circles like they usually do in Kabbalah books, and you think of God or the actor or whoever is the center of consciousness somehow starting out on a journey from the periphery, from the overall, the biggest circle to the center circle there, or vice versa, you have a nice convenient way of looking at Chekhov and Stanislavski. If you start off with the idea that, for example, if I take Chekhov thinking here, and I'm the actor, and I radiate out a ray, and I project it on the wall over there of a character, and I'm looking at a grasshopper jumping around, and then I go play act my grasshopper, I've done from the center to the outer. I've started with the idea that I am God, or I am the creator of this world. I project the ray out there, which is, Kabbalistically speaking, I'm going from Adam to Eve, or from Chochmah to Bina, or from Metatron to the ether, whatever you want to, however you want to conceptualize it, or from the top layer to the bottom layer, from Keter to Malchut. That's all technical jargon. But the point is, you're starting from some center of consciousness and projecting a world, and then you go out there and embody the world. And if you then build up the world of that character, all kinds of aspects of that, you're basically embodying the whole Kabbalah, and you're basically embodying exactly what Chekhov wants you to do. And by doing that process, starting from the center and build what he calls becoming friends with the whole, every element in the production, including the elements, which you get a message, which is the message that the production and you want to give to the audience. And that's exactly the same idea, the encompassing envelope, the big idea that encompasses all little ideas, except you're starting from this one center of consciousness and starting with building a whole world. The Gestalt process is the exact opposite. You start from the outer, the bigger one, which we're gonna, the world of everyday life. And instead of generating a whole world, you just say, I'm aware of this, and now I'm aware of that, and now I'm aware of that. Three little awarenesses, and then I integrate those, and they say, ah, it looks like I'm aware of a red spot. I integrated, actually what I integrated was about a gazillion sensory neurons in my brain or whatever, in my retina. All those gestalts come together, and I started from the big, from this world, and I started integrating. Building it up. And little by little, I keep going until I get to the superobjective. And that's what he did when he did his 2 hours of Gestalt therapy. He got to some idea of a wiser state. Since it's no big secret here, we can talk about it. Usually, you know, when you work with an actor, you want to keep everything private. But since it's all on the internet anyway, we can talk about it. So the key word for the integrated state, the superobjective, would be cooperation, where he discovers that instead of two sides fighting each other so much, it's possible that there could be a little centering going on and seeing things from a higher point of view of integration. And that came out of not starting with big arguments with people, but starting with just, I'm aware of this, I'm aware of that, and integrating that together. So he started from the outer circle and worked his way to the center circle. And that's exactly what Stanislavski does in creating a role. You start from one little moment with this, with your scene partner. Another thing, next thing, the next thing, you get to the super objective. So Stanislavski is starting from the outer circle, going to the inner circle. Michael Chekhov is starting from the inner circle, going to the outer circle. And we are doing both of them together. Okay, so that's Stanislavski. And I needed to give you some background, because otherwise, you know, just watching him jump around here and make some noises, you know, you say, oh, it's just another physical theater thing. I could have seen that 50 years ago watching Joseph Chaykin or something like that. But there's a big difference between this and Joseph Chaykin. Chaykin was a muscle. This here is we're going to see, is a guided muscle. There's a method to the madness here, an underlying thread of consciousness. And we're saying here that the threat of consciousness is crucial. It is the PG. It is the psychological gestures, except we're going to call it the objective history, which is an encompassing idea of an underlying phenomenology of the spirit, which, as a matter of fact, is exactly the foundation that since Stanislavski and Brecht and all these directors of the 20th century and the 20th, and now this century, everybody's into this. The trouble is, most of them don't know what they're doing. They don't really know what they're doing. They're doing something which somebody told them to do, or they read in the book, without really understanding it. So here we're trying to give you A, the understanding, and B, the doing at the same time. I'm sure I've lost 3/4 of you by now, but if anyone is still around, maybe you'll be ready to assimilate some of this stuff, okay? All right, I think I've gotten to the end of my introduction. Let me just be sure here. Okay, that's a good thing. Wait a thought. Let me just think. Did I leave anything out? No, okay. So the next thing you're going to see, no way, actually, what you just saw at the beginning of this video, we did that to get your attention, was our guinea pig here doing what I just said. He ran through his objective history without the usual music that we work with and without any explanations. Just he kind of strung together these four major moments and that he got to in his work. And let's see, strung. And that's all I did. It's just the raw material. I had to rehearse it a few times. And later in this video, we're going to start from that basic skeleton, that basic objective history, and we're going to show how the transition works. It's already a transition. It's already, he's already moved from hot personal stuff that he's maybe him sometimes in certain ways embarrassed about showing. There's a little bit of a beginning to be a sense of a performer performing, although certain things are probably sensitive. We'll work on some of that. Okay, so that's... and so he was doing now, you remember, he's doing basically Stanislavski or Gestalt therapy, starting from moments of awareness, and the superobjective, he's going to deal with the point of view of looking back from the point of view of cooperation, and looking back at examples of lack of cooperation, showing how the idea of cooperation evolved from experiences and gradually congealed from these awareness moments. Okay.
Oh.
The next procedure we're going to do here gives me an association. Maybe it might be interesting to mention that I have a BA in chemistry, and I did almost 2 years of medical school. And Mr. Blank here has a PhD in biology. He's professor of biology, teaching biology. Why is it relevant? Because what we're going to do now is we're going to take this thing called the superobjective, and that's always been a big mystery since Stanislavski started talking about it in a very vague way. And we're going to analyze it. We're going to bring it into our laboratory, take it apart. What is it? Exactly. And we're going to show you that it ain't a big mystery after all. It's just the old idea that that they call the wisdom of hindsight. Simply the idea of wisdom of hindsight that anyone can do. Not no big deal. For example, you take a trip, you know, you got a flat on the way, and then you look back, oh, gee, if I only had known, if I should have brought an extra spare tire, you know. And now I know, you know, I'm a sadder and a wiser fellow. Same thing here. So now I'll get specific. When this guy did, if you look back at those videos, those 2 one-hour videos that make up his work on the awareness, he worked through a bunch of different things, and we focused on 4 major moments of that, 4 major places like where there were clear opposites, and the body involved, and the voice involved, and the imagination involved. Okay, so that's what we needed as raw material for our work on the psychological gestures. Now, from the point of view of the guy that finished doing all that after 2 hours and looked back at it, the conclusion he reached at the end of the message he got from the work, the existential message he got, as it was, which is what we call it in Gestalt therapy, or the word of God you would get if you talked about it in terms of the Kabbalah, the unfolding, you know, of the divine light, or whatever you want to think about it that way. The message is, it's a good idea to cooperate. It's, rather than just, you know, 2 people just beating each other over the head, each one trying to win, rather maybe if we cooperate we can accomplish the objectives better. So the key word for the super objective here is cooperation, and that, looking back at it, we can say that in a certain sense the idea of cooperation, if we go along with Aristotle, for example, is some kind of an unmoved mover here that was pulling the thing forward from the beginning. Aristotle would say that actuality is prior to potentiality. Actuality is prior to potentiality. That's a fancy way of saying that when you begin a strong action that you're totally committed to, the reality of that action is there from the beginning as a kind of a guiding idea that's pulling you forward somehow, and then all the things you do along the way to materialize that idea were there as seeds at the beginning, and they grew out of this process of trying to realize that idea. It's like this magnet pulling you forward. The same idea, you know, when you find in Genesis, if you read what's his name? Rashi's interpretation of Genesis, I think I found it there, that somehow or other the idea of creation was there in the first second. They even make a big deal out of it, calling that the bee, the Bereshit or something like that. But it's somehow the pure idea that's there, and then God has the idea of the first second and the first microsecond. And then it takes him 6 days for all the potential things, all the seeds to develop. And then on a 7th day, he pulls it all together, you know, and integrates the whole thing. So we have this pure idea of the one in the many, God in the world, all these potential fragments here coming together in the idea of the Sabbath. And that's the moment of rest when everything comes together, the cycle is complete, and then he's ready to start the whole thing again, you know, the next microsecond, to create the next microsecond. The same thing here, except we're slowing it down to show you how it works. So what we're going to do here is have this guinea pig of ours run through his maze, and each time he gets to the end of one of his cycles, one of his thesis, antithesis, synthesis things, he's going to stop. And from the point of view of the superobjective, he's going to look back at that moment, that beat, that scene that he worked through, and tell you what it has to do with the idea of the final superobjective of the idea of cooperation. at this point I realize this, and then he'll do the next, no, he'll do the next beat, and he'll tell you, nah, now I realize this. And there are four of those. The difference between this and what we did at the beginning when we showed you the whole sequence is that here we're going to do it with music. The actual music we used when we did the Gestalt work, so that you'll see where those PGs exactly were coming from. He was using, the way it worked was, he would have a particular experience, and I would ask him, or an image, and I would ask him, you know, what music would go with that if that were a movie, and he'd give me a suggestion, and we'd come up with some music. And he'd do the whole thing with the music, and the music would help him to exaggerate it, to make the PGs as strong, clear as possible from a performing point of view, because we know, also from a therapy point of view, they say in Gestalt therapy, say it with your whole body. So the music helped him to get to say it with his whole body. So we're going to show you here where it came, where that particular PG came from in the process, and then how it relates to the superobjective, as though this were a four-act tragedy here, and he's looking at the thing from the point of view of the mystical superobjective, except we realize it's no big deal, it's simply the wisdom of hindsight. All right, so here we go now with the first one of those PGs, the first one of those items. We're using some music from Philip Glass, which associates to the idea, actually he was working with the idea somehow of a machine. So he's helping the music, music is helping him to get into the idea of a machine. Now what a machine has to do with the superobjective, he'll tell you about that later. Okay, but that's what's going on here psychologically, okay? All right.
I just performed, I think it was Cog in the Wheels. Why? I grew up in a typical nuclear family and grew up with TV, thinking of Beaver, Leave It to Beaver and television shows like that, that everything was always perfect. And all we had to do was be just another cog in the great wheel of humankind, and that would be simple. But as I grew up, and even as I am today, I realize we don't have to just be a cog in the wheel. We can break out of that. And that music from Philip Glass helps. That repetitive music and that pattern, that beat, really drills into your mind what we've been brainwashed. We don't have to accept that. And we can be perfectly happy, functioning adults without having that sort of brainwash. And that helps me towards a super objective of resolution. I'm always in a box like a cog. I have to break out of that cog, that box, and see.
Okay, now, I'm sort of interviewing you here. Remember, the super objective, the conclusion you reached in the last part of the work was in cooperation. Remember, there was that image of being working together to get out of that ice cave. And right. Somehow cooperation. Now, what does that cooperation have to do with the machine idea? See, this machine thing was the first step in arriving at that. So you got to think that there are four steps that took you to this point of the point of view of cooperation. So this was the first step. What is it? Maybe this step simply showed you what the problem was. How would you describe the relationship between this first PG and the final superobjective? Okay.
This one, really, you don't see that you can get outside. You're part of the problem.
When I'm stuck in this,
it's like a dog chasing its tail. Cog, just going around, a mechanical cog going around and around. But when I'm able to look outside that and look back, I see that, no, I don't have to be part of that. I can break free of that and come to a conclusion and a cooperation, a good resolution. But I didn't see that. And when I think about the time in my life I referred to as that, I was blinded. I wasn't able to see that at all.
So now, for example, now that if I'm directing you, say, and if we're trying to put you into a five-act tragedy or four-act tragedy here, and so in act number one, we have a character that's somehow stuck like in a machine somehow, right?
Yeah, and a lot of people are like that. And I can use that now as a mask, or an archetype, to use a different type of
word. So you can use this as a PG, right? And then the lead, this particular details that you work out about the character, for example, whether it's an old man or a young lady, whatever it is that the role is, you would overlay onto this underlying PG. But in your mind is the idea of this machine is going on and on and on with the music of maybe.
It's another tool to make me a more effective actor. Mm-hmm. And make me be able to play other roles, but have a whole repertoire in my mind of what works for these different roles.
Let's kind of replay. We couldn't imagine what the opposite was. You know, if he's a machine, you know, where's the opposition here? There's no opposition in that image itself. But then we started thinking. It came out of a discussion of the nuclear family situation, childhood. And so we somehow the mechanicalness, and I think I might have given him this machine exercise. Did we do that? We did a machine exercise.
Yeah.
So the machine exercise, one person does a machine, do some mechanical repetitive thing. Right. You're doing that, okay. And I'm like the guy that's running the machine here and making him go faster and faster and faster.
Oh!
Explodes. Okay? So in this case the opposition, well, there's no opposition, he's just a slave to this powerful overwhelming force. Now if we in that context, so what in your life, if you think back at your childhood there, which we were talking about at the time, what was the force that was winding you up so much?
I was a post-Kennedy baby. I was born right after John F. Kennedy was murdered, assassinated. And my parents' mentality and everyone growing up still had the Sputnik. We had to outdo the Russians. We had to beat those Russians. We had to be the best in math, the best in Little League. Everything had to be the best and perfect. And you know what? I didn't like that. But it took me a long time, many, many years. And even now, I still have some of that resentment. I don't know what to call it exactly. Why?
So that was the whole hippies environment. That's what gave birth. Me too. I mean, my rebelled against that, and I walked out of medical school in the middle. My father never forgave me. Okay. So there it is. In this case, there's no opposition. It's just in terms of the theory, you might say we have what Fritz Perls would call a pompous ass piece of shit relationship here. We have this overwhelming force. and he's a nobody, and he just gotta, you know, do what he's told. And then, although the commands, might, you know, certainly were not verbal, you know, but the environment was a powerful force. Okay?
I don't know if the commands weren't so verbal.
Oh, they were verbal.
Oh, I remember, I'm not going to say the person's name, but I remember in junior high school, the disciplinarian, he used a lot of words, and they were followed by a pretty good paddle on the backside. And there was definitely verbal and physical strictures that were very definite ones.
In my case, it was mostly positive rewards. I kept getting more and more, you know, honors and, you know, encouragement from everybody. So why rebel, you know? Anyway, okay, so that's essence number one. And we see the physical form, and we see the, and we see the psychological roots of it. So it's something that's going to work a lot better than open and close, you know?
Yeah,
this
yeah.
is something you can feel, right?
This is real. And this is based on working through life experiences and places. I remember when I first came in here, one of the things I discussed was how I felt stuck. Not just this box image, but I was stuck. There are places in my life I was stuck. Uh-huh. Didn't process them. I didn't know what to do with them. And now I process them a little bit. We haven't done that much work.
Uh-huh.
And when doing them, I'm freeing myself through these, through theater.
Okay, now from the point of view of the superobjective that you learned about cooperation, what does this have to do with cooperation?
At that time, I wasn't cooperating. But the system was very constrained. I don't know if there really was even a concept of cooperation in that system.
Yeah. It wasn't two equals dealing with each other. It was one overwhelming force and the other zero force.
But the interesting thing about that time, I was on the tail end of it, but like yourself a little bit, with this idea of being a hippie, that was very enticing because it seemed to be a society, groups of people who were all about cooperation. And I was attracted to that at that time.
Okay, so it was like unconsciously maybe the beginning of the superobjective happening, and that's exactly what's supposed to happen in a properly directed tragedy, is that the final message is there from the beginning for people that have a, you know, enough literary sensibility to read between the lines, you know, even though in Act One, this is just Act One of the tragic comedy here, it's not explicit, but somehow or other is the idea that there's some, well, that this is something, there's something not kosher not about this total master-slave relationship here. And maybe it has something to do with, you know, a more contactful relationship between human beings. Okay, very good.
Now we're looking at the underlying psychology, the reviewing a little bit the material that went by in those 2 hours of awareness work. We did the first one already, so now we're looking at the second one.
The second one is fear of the unknown, and you'll see, you saw first, or without any music, a monster figure and a person being very afraid, actually so afraid they die, they become nifter from their fear. But what's really going on
nifter
here?
Nifter means dead.
Dead, yeah, dead as a doorknob, as we say.
Oh.
So what's going on here in my own life, and what am I going through in this figure, is that fear,
many times... Well, what's the opposite? There's two forces, there's always an X and a minus X. So
okay.
There's one force which is scaring you, right?
Right. And that's really what that force is, the unknown.
The unknown.
And what's the opposite of that? It's the known. And not becoming gripped in fear and terror of not knowing. You know, a lot of times in our life we're faced with these problems and we don't know what's going to happen. We may not even be sure of the problem. But if we become overwhelmed with the fear, again, I said earlier, you're blinded, you can't see. And what I realize now, looking back, is that this fear is really unknown. And how much of that unknown is reality? So much of it is imagined. And you peel back the imagined part, and you're left with a small kernel that you can deal with.
Now, looking at from the point of view of the superobjective, remember that the final message that you got from this 2 hours of work was that somehow or other, it maybe it's worth the trouble to cooperate. Now, from that point of view, what does this fear have to do with it?
Well, if you're stuck, really stuck in fear, you can't cooperate. And if your partner is also stuck in fear, could be from a different place, they can't cooperate either. You have to get rid of this. You have to throw it away. Put it on the shelf. Now, get rid of it.
Now, if we look at our four-act tragedy comedy here, going back, remember what was happening in Act 1. Act 1 was this machine feeling impotent against the forces of overwhelming forces of society in those days, encouraging people to succeed at all costs or something like that, and rewarding cognitive activity and penalizing things that interfered with that. So from that point of view, if this is the second step, what does it have to do with the first
step? Well, this is a progression. The first step is you're numb. You're in a society, you're stuck in your own way.
Rather than you, I
was numb. And so I didn't feel anything. Now I'm progressing in a positive psychological, positive whole person experience.
Yeah.
And I'm feeling. What's one of the first fears and one of the primordial feelings is fear. But it's a big improvement from being numb, being under like the influence of Novocaine.
This fits right into the theory of Gestalt therapy. You know, the least aware person, the deadest person, is for example, an autistic child, perhaps, or a schizophrenic. They call it confluence. A person is totally locked into their habits, their rituals, confluent, flowing with your habits, your rituals, and with no blocking out any awareness that might interfere with that routine. Okay. So the second step is introject, where you're beginning to have some awareness, but what your awareness consists of just swallowing whole all the commands you get from some authoritarian person or society or a dibbuk, being possessed by some kind of a dibbuk, and just basically having that person take over your decision-making capacity. And the next step would be projection, where you're feeling, so that's introjection. Jektari is to throw, you throw something in, the authority figure. Projection is where you throw it out, your own aggression, rather than using your aggression, you project it onto other people, they're going to get me, or they're going to rape me, or whatever it is. And retroflexion is the next step, where the energy is coming out, but you turn it against yourself, and get involved in rigid habits, like rocking or whatever. We're making your muscles tense, and remember we worked on muscle tension. And then finally, egotism, where you're stuck into some kind of a frozen idea of who you think you are, and that keeps you from letting yourself go. So these are the different stages from the therapy point of view. And I And we see we're already touching on that so far.
Yes, no, it's very good. And you can see, going from closed in, that I was closed in and not open to options, and slowly opening. And by the end, you'll see how I am open to options, and including doing more theater now. So it's a good, healthy progression, even with these two elements that you'll see that reflects on.
Mm-hmm. Third element.
Okay, the third element is alone at the beach. And it's myself. I'm alone at the beach. And a lot of times in some of the imagery work we did together, I would see myself floating up and down on the waves and feel the warmth of the sun and a lot of freedom and a total body relaxation, which is very hard for me to do.
And we used, you're going to hear Debussy's La Mer.
Yeah.
And by the way, the second one, we forgot to mention it. That was Penderecki's Capriccio, okay?
So I wanted the beach, and I find myself yearning a lot of time to spend periods of every day alone and relaxed. And in the figure I do without the music, and I'm going to do again here, something happened at the end. I'm not so sure I want to discuss it now.
Okay.
But there is something.
Remember, basic principle of Gestalt work is you're free to censor. The more material you share, the more we got. And you're free to lie. It doesn't matter. You just.
Oh, it's not about censoring.
Oh, it's not.
No. It's just. No, it's okay. I'll discuss it now.
It's up to you.
Okay. No, it's just that. So every time I get this image, especially the beach, I'm totally relaxed. And I've been playing in the water and swimming and floating, body surfing maybe. All these things I love and I grew up doing as a child at the beach in the Atlantic Ocean. As I get the most relaxed, whether it's in imagery work or in a little bit of the work we're doing here now, pangs of guilt come back. And what is it? It's because I feel bad. I'm not with my children. I'm worried about my children. What are they doing? What's my wife doing? Why aren't they with me? And it's a bit of a conflict. And I think it's a healthy conflict.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all I really want to say about the that figure right now.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Did you want to add something to that right now about the third figure?
So there are two kinds of music. There's two sides here. The one is the calm side, and the other is the one that's kind of attacking and saying you should be doing this and you should be doing that. That's what they call in Gestalt therapy, maybe a top dog underdog conflict, where the top dog is making the judgments, you should be doing this and you should be doing that. And the other dog is feeling, oh, okay, I'll do it, I'll get around to it, yeah. So at the initial state, you're relaxing, and then little by little, this judgment element moves in, and that way you represented that, so you'll show two sides, right? You show the first relax, and then you show them with the second kind of
towards the end,
La Mer. There's other kind of music that this the third section of La Mer, that suite that Debussy wrote about the ocean, is supposed to represent a storm, and the storm associates to the idea of all the conflicts. Okay, so that way the music again helps to consolidate the psychological gesture and the major opposition between relaxed form, in a sense an open form, but and the other one's a much more tight and closed defensive form. And you notice the difference between this idea of open and close. The stereotype, just open and close, you know, just like an accordion. This has, the distinction here is between a quality and a gesture. This has the quality, has the individuality, the texture of the form. So it's a live form. A PG needs to be a psychological gesture, needs to be a live form, not a dead form, not a stereotype. But it's not. Otherwise, it's not going to give the performer the grounding he needs to feed off of it, to work off of it. Okay. Thank you.
conflict. And this is kind of the idea that you progress and you regress. And unending conflict is there's no resolution. You're stuck. You're really stuck and you don't see any way out. And it's almost like you're going crazy within your mind. It doesn't have to be physically outside your body. And it's going back and forth and back and forth. But again, the end is breaking out of this conflict. You don't have to be in conflict. I don't have to be in conflict. I don't have to accept it. I can just, you know, like breaking through glass. I can just break it. Enough. That's all. It's very hard. Because a lot of us, I personally, seem to thrive on conflict. It's not healthy.
You notice the way the language is an important element of Gestalt work. The metaphor he used, breaking through, like breaking glass, you know, that's a violent image of language. And yet, the last image you had, that led to the cooperation idea, didn't have that kind of language involved, right?
No.
So now this is the fourth one.
Yeah.
Fourth one. Just before actually there were five images.
Yeah, yeah. There's five. Fifth one.
So it's a five-act tragedy. Isn't that amazing? So how does this one relate to the other three? The one before it and the one after it. Why should this be an act four instead of act one, for example?
Because it's normal ups and downs of life. You know, I go up on a roller coaster and down, and as I progress through life, the ups and downs get smaller, but they're still there. And so you see, the first one, okay, there was no up or down, there's no choice. The second one, there's choice but fear, but overcoming that. Third one is total relaxation, but then guilt. And the fourth one's coming back, this conflict. What do I do? I'm still at conflict. Into the fifth one, which okay, can I talk about the fifth one now? I'm a little confused where we're holding.
All right, go ahead. Okay. Mention it.
The fifth one, it's resolution.
Because the fifth one, we don't really have a physical form for it.
Yeah, it's a difficult one. The fifth
one reason is because it was the end of the session and it was the time to stop, but also because we didn't need a form because it was such as basically a normal life situation, right?
Yeah, I mean the fifth one is cooperation. And realizing that you can back off.
Well, maybe let's describe the situation for somebody that might not have seen it.
Okay.
The first one was, describe the image for just a little bit.
I had an image in my mind of ice climbing. I did an ice climb many years ago in Rocky Mountain National Park. Very physical, very demanding. A huge climb, a well-known climb, ice climb called Jaws, which is this enormous curtain of ice. And the first pitch, the first length of rope, you go up and one of the options is, which we took, you end into an ice cave, which is cold and blue, but feeling very protective. And it took me a long time. I didn't lead it, I was the second person on the rope. And when I got up there, I was pretty gripped with terror and fear and a lot of the elements we discussed before. But I didn't admit to it. So after we got set up again, first person, the leader, left out, climbed almost upside down out of this ice cave, seemingly very vertical, and then out over the top of the lip, and left me behind in perfect clear and blue light coming through, the white and blue light reflecting
the blue light reflecting through the ice and the white light from the snowfield.
Get to the point about cooperation.
Okay. But when he finished the climb, I couldn't go further. So through a series of signals on the rope and shouts, couldn't really hear each other very well. He had to down climb, he came down, and we had a discussion, which is cooperation, to discuss a problem. Yeah. Not to fight, you have to go, the only way is up, the only way is down. What are we going to do together? And he came up with a plan that I agreed to. Turned out to be more difficult, but we traversed across, and then we lowered ourselves down, we rappelled down, actually in the dark at that point, when we were off the ice of a ledge. And it was a feeling of exhilaration that we overcame a big problem. And it's funny, I hadn't thought about it for decades. Many, many decades later, I hadn't even remembered such a thing. It came back to my mind as a clear...
Now, gestalt work, we might call that... Usually what happens when you get one of these aha moments at the end of the session, they call that an explosion into authentic emotion, authentic action. So here we have, and that's, you can think of that as usually explosion into joy, or anger, or orgasm, or what's the other one? Sadness, grief. Okay, so here was a nice explosion into joy, exhilaration. All right.
That's the image that one of the figures I've been using. There's that ice climbing and all this thing, it's hard to act it out without any physical backdrop and stuff, but one of the things it did at the end was exhilaration.
Yeah.
Exhilaration is a beautiful feeling of completeness.
So there's the idea of a superobjective. It's loaded with emotional energy, at the same time it's closure on a problem. It's totally focused, and it somehow encompasses all of the preceding elements that led up to it. And that's exactly what it's supposed to be for Stanislavski. Except he got to it, he got to it in the same way. As a matter of fact, it is a Stanislavski process of creating a world from moments of awareness to leading up to be more and more encompassing envelopes of experience. Leading up to the superobjective, the final idea, the explosion of the joy, and all the pieces are there. It's a lovely example of work, and this is without even a dream. This is just working on what are you aware of now, you know? Okay, very good. Okay, so I guess that finishes our discussion of this particular thing.